plays a part, but I know right now he's feeling really good about it.
I was going to say, those Cowies are designed with that start system, and they put a lot of attention into that, and guys traditionally do pretty well starting on Cowies.
So with Eli switching to a team that has as much prestige as Monster Energy Kawasaki, is there going to be extra pressure on him to prove himself?
I think of course there is, right? Here's the things that he's going to be fighting at A1. Pressure of A1, pressure of lead man on the team, and pressure of coming back from injury, right? Because he wants to prove everybody, like, hey, I'm fine. I'm going to smoke these guys. Those three things can be a big downfall if he's not careful. We all know he can ride. He knows he can ride. He's a fast guy out there. Those three things, I think, can probably cause him problems if he's not making good decisions in his head during the race.
Could he start getting in his own head and worrying about those three things? Like, could that – do you expect that to affect him?
Can you put it all together? You know, now it's time. You're on the gate. Everyone's there. The pressure's on. And Anaheim 1 is always, I felt, a bit of a tough one because everyone's maybe a little overexcited.
No doubt.
So there seems to be people plowing into each other in heat races. Just a lot of little things that don't seem to happen later in the season. But you got to get through that first to give yourself a chance later in the season.
You heard it from Grant Langston right here. A1 is going to be like a giant LCQ.
Well, not only is it going to be a giant LCQ, I mean, look, it's pouring down rain all today. We've seen pictures across the internet. There's tarps over the track right now. There's about a foot of water sitting on Anaheim 1 racetrack right now. You
is
guys keep
built?
On talking about what?
Is it built? It's yet? Built.
It's built, yeah.
Yeah, it's built. Because they check the weather forecast.
That's a plus.
Yeah, they check the weather forecast. They know it's coming. So if they see rain's going to be there, they're going to get in there a couple days early. And you guys are talking to Eli Tomac, Monster Energy Kawasaki. I want to talk about Baker's factory. You have
right.
Skin. He's moving into the 450s. You have Jason Anderson, who is definitely a wild card sophomore year of the 450s. Then you got the champ. You got Ryan Dungey, the number one bike. And he's on quite a streak. And like you guys said, A1, they're going to be coming out banging bars. It's going to be a lot of nerves going on. What is going to happen at the podium? I'm kind of at a loss for words because you have eight contenders that anything could happen that night. Who could take
Why
a win?
Why is Miss Supercross always worried about what the podium is going to look like?
Oh, God.
Hey, listen.
Isn't that just difficult?
It's funny. It's funny
That's
because this exact conversation happened an hour ago with EJ at Monster.
Oh, really?
So what we should do is we should run down the list of the top 10 guys here that we see, and we should – let's talk about them.
Well,
I mean,
let me just say, I think that Baker's going to find a way to bring out the hidden tiger in the crouching tiger in old Dungey.
Well, you know what I just absolutely love about the Baker story is Filippotto retires, okay? Now all of a sudden the contender that was against Filippotto, Ryan Dungey, now picks up – Baker and Roxon's off the roster. It's like he is like the focal point of Baker's factory, right? And
yeah, but you know, Dungey had Baker before, so they like
when he worked with
they worked together, and Dungey's been trying to get him back. So I mean, with that being said, Dungey thinks he's got the key to the lock now, right? Because he's got Baker.
I think it's been more of a mental,
but Dungey's always approached it kind of like it's a puzzle. He just got to put the puzzle together.
Well, you know, he's also another rider he's always been very open. His mind has always played a lot of tricks on him. He's always like, what can I do? Am I doing enough? Am I not doing enough? Am I overtraining? Am I not overtraining? He's constantly always been open about those
with
questions.
With that being said, though, he has the best strategy out there, right? He's the one winning the titles.
Yeah.
As unsure as he might be at certain times, he's the one winning the title. So his strategy in racecraft right now is what everyone needs to be shooting for and figure out how to get that piece of the puzzle
right.
put together, because Dungey's puzzle right now is the winning puzzle.
Well, I think what that is he now doesn't guess or question what he's doing. He believes in what he's doing because he's got Alden behind him, and Alden's got a track record. So I think for Ryan, that was just that little mental piece of the puzzle that just said, I got the best trainer, and then Roger DaCosta and them worked on a new bike. When that new bike came out, I knew before he even rode it, that he was so excited because the KTM guys were saying the new bike's the bomb. It's, you know, it's the business.
When you saw him ride it, though,
that,
it was apparent.
Between that and the Alden factor putting in with the fact that Ryan, we know that he can ride and he knows he can ride, you combine that and with Villopoto retiring, I think at this point mentally he's very strong. But what I like about Dungey, he doesn't get too cocky or too confident. And I think a little bit of that unsurety keeps him humble and keeps him hungry, which
keeps
is what keeps him coming back.
Status.
Exactly.
Yeah.
He doesn't come in thinking, I've got this. I mean, he's even said, I think Roczen may have more raw talent and maybe more raw speed in Supercross. You know, so I've got to overcome that and be, you know, the guy that's there every weekend. I know it sounds cliche, but it's
we know he's riding with Anderson, too, and Anderson beat
and
him.
And that helps.
100%
and they're pushing
right
each
now.
Other. They're pushing each other as well.
Yeah. Right now, for the season, my money would be on Dungey.
I know that we're going to break. I emailed Casey Lytle of KTM's R&D department, and I have a few little nugs.
Nice.
So,
look at you going
hey
deep.
Girl.
When we come back, Loretta will tell us all about that. Folks, the Action Sports Show powered by Toyota Escondido. It's the Supercross Preview Show right here live. We'll be right back.
Know that Toyota of Escondido has a huge selection of new and used Toyotas, right? But I bet they have a few more things you didn't even know, like a certified collision center. If you're ever in an accident, get your Toyota fixed with the proper parts it was meant to have at Escondido's only Toyota certified collision center.
Toyota of Escondido. Toyota of Escondido.
Looking to save money? Toyota of Escondido has a full refinance department. Keep your current car no matter the make or model and let Toyota of Escondido's refinance team help lower your monthly payment or current interest rate. Visit ToyotaEscondido.com and click the refinance tab.
Toyota of Escondido.
ToyotaEscondido.com. Shop for your new Toyota and much, much more.
The boys are back with two huge events coming to the Southland. Monster Energy Supercross. Brought to you by Mission Motorsports Irvine. January 9th. It all starts with the season opener. Then follow the action one more time when the best riders take over Anaheim January 23rd, all at Angels Stadium. Get your tickets now at Ticketmaster and participating Yamaha dealers. All seats $5 more to have show. Prices subject to market demand. Additional fees apply. January 9th and January 23rd only at Angels Stadium.
What's up? This is Robbie Madison. You're listening to the Action Sports Show, where all things action sports goes on. Tell your mama I said hello and keep it wide open.
You're on, guys.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Action Sports Show, powered by Toyota Escondido Action Sports. If you're just joining us, this is the Supercross Preview Special. I want to let you all know, if you're listening online, go ahead and follow the social media at TE Action Sports. That's at TE Action Sports. And subscribe to the podcast so you can go back and check this out again later. But, hey, we're joined on one heck of a panel here tonight. I'm Jim Holtis, Lorette Nickel, Grant Langston, Diana Dahlgren, Jeremy McGrath, and champion Dan McGranahan, all live here in-house.
Zero time.
Zero titles.
Zero time.
That's zero time.
That's what your tramp stamp's going to say, right?
Whoa, Jesus.
Just maybe.
Had to bring that up, didn't
you? O-time. No, put an O-time on his tramp stamp.
O-time.
Too soon?
Not showtime and not no time, but O-time.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, one of those when the Razor showed up and you go, oh.
Oh.
Time to get out of here.
She must be South African.
So, Lorette, you had some tidbits right before we went to break.
No, nugs.
Nugs. I got some nugs.
She got some nuggets.
Are they fear nugs or what?
Fear nugs?
No, they're fresh nugs.
They're tidbits.
Yeah.
Nugs.
Yeah. So, Casey Lytle works in the R&D department at KTM. And so, a few things that he told me. Dungey is on the same chassis as last year. Jason Anderson's Husqvarna chassis was updated for 2016, complete new bike and engine package. From the R&D side, KTM has been working for a few years with Roger DeCosta on building a bike that performs well in Supercross and Motocross. The latest generation of bikes is the result of the close relationship they have. And finally, another goal of 2016 was weight. So the standard bikes are now the lightest bikes available, even with the electric start. And that gives the race team a great advantage when trying to get the bike to weight, to the weight limit for racing.
Well, they do have one issue. They went a little too light on their spokes. Because they got a
wheel. I know. They have a recall.
Yeah, but we can guarantee that Dungey and Anderson and Muskin are not racing a standard rear wheel.
Exactly. They also have a tie kit on their bike, so they'll go thicker spokes and thicker nipples. Nipples, Diana, actually on the wheel.
Listen,
by the rim.
Do you think I'm a rookie? Langston, do you think I'm a rookie?
No, I just wanted to make sure. I just want to make sure you're on the same
page. You know, that's a good point because if they go under the limit, then they can put the weight back on the skid plate.
Yeah.
Put the weight
Keep
where
the weight
want.
Low skip and down the wheat, in the middle.
The lower center gravity.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Down to the bottom. So
they do have a very light bike. What I think is going to be the biggest difference is based off, you know, your email is, I think the Husqvarna guys are a bigger advantage because the older generation Husky was – just that. It was an older version of the KTM. Basically, Husky pretty much now have the same kind of components, or they have the access to the same kind of components as the KTM, as well as it's been updated. So I think the biggest advantage is for guys like Porcel and Anderson, basically factory Husqvarna. They've got a bike that's been proven to win. And like you said, Lorette, Dungey didn't change his chassis, so you know he likes it. He's comfortable. I mean, we all know, Jeremy, you're better off being comfortable than – risking a change.
Most definitely.
So if he's comfortable, you know that 2015 bike was good if he hasn't changed it.
It's an interesting fact that you pointed out is if Anderson's on the updated bike, is this the same bike he might have been riding at Monster Energy Cup? Because
yes,
he was lightning fast, right?
It was.
So,
lightning.
So it's safe to say that, you know, I like to, you know, think of Jason Anderson as kind of he's the new Mike LaRocco, right? He's super fast. But he's invisible sometimes, right?
Yeah.
We forget about him a little bit. And the kid is amazing, right? So this year could be a breakout year for him. And I think, you know, if he's confident and he believes that he has – obviously, he believes he has the same equipment as Dungey, I think there's no reason he's not going to be
same trainer, same equipment. But someone that I did hear from a few little birdies that is struggling a little bit on the 450 is Muskin. I've heard from people inside and around the team that – he's still just trying to get, you know, acclimatized to the 450. Maybe, you know, Marvin with his size and a little too finesse, I think he might have to bring a little bit of a Barsher kind of attitude maybe to, you know, sometimes with those 450s nowadays, you got to kind of bulldog him. You got to be a little bit strong.
A little look bam at, bam.
Yeah, you got to have a little bam bam in you. Like, look at Tomac. Look at the guys that are doing well. Even Dungey. One thing I noticed in the last year with working with Alden is how much more he moves around on the bike. And that's important. So I think,
but you know, as well as anybody, you can only if you feel the bike's capable and you're comfortable doing that, you'll push to that level, right? If Muskin's not ready yet, you know, and he's
or maybe he's just not comfortable,
Yeah. Dean Wilson's pretty young. How's he adapting? I mean, I haven't really heard anything much about
I've
him
heard
in the
he
off
looks,
season.
I heard he looks good. He's been putting in a lot of hard work, a lot of training. So
good.
From what I've heard, it sounds like we might be able to see a little bit of the old Dino that we've been hoping to see for
That'd
a while.
That'd be nice.
Yeah.
Well, Dean, that mixes things up so much.
Yeah, Dean said 2015 was a season that he'd really like to forget.
Yeah.
You know, it's great that he has a teammate that he can look up to, and Muskin's goals were to learn, and he said it's a big change for him on the 450, and he hasn't raced the West Coast for many years, so he's relearning in a sense, right?
I just really am. I just need a break from seeing him doing heel clickers.
So he's still on Christmas break, essentially, right? Because he doesn't usually start until March.
Right.
I
so mean, it's a new mindset.
He's going to be racing a lot earlier. And
yep.
Well, he is the rookie that we're looking out for. And I think that if he's riding with Dungey and he has Wilson and then he's also under Baker's camp, I mean, he's pitted against the fastest dudes.
He's a gamer.
He's a gamer.
I think he'll step. I agree with you.
You've
I think
seen
he'll
him when
step
he gets
on
the gate, he just like turns it up. Yeah, I mean, you've seen that before.
That's what we've seen on the 250s. I mean, what it took him like just less than a season to get acclimated to Supercross when he came over from France. So, I mean, I know it's a complete change up of bike going from power, you know, 250 power to 450 power, but I think that he's motivated and riding with people with the mentalities like Dungy. It's only going to make him better and push him to be not this underdog rookie.
There's no doubt. You guys also brought up another name a moment ago, and this guy, you know, a couple of years ago, you would have thrown this name out, and we would have all been like, "Oh yeah, you better bet he's going to be a factor."
Barcia.
And
No.
He's still a factor. Porcel.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
You know, when we talk about dark horses, I don't even have him on my dark horse list anymore. But we all know what he's done. We all know what he's
capable. Yeah. What has he done?
He rode around the outside lines and found some smooth track and won some races.
What year was that?
And he had a lot of hot laps in outdoors. He was fastest in qualifying. Porcel has to put the package together.
Well, maybe you make a really clear point. Actually,
it's pretty clear.
Well, what's your clear point that you're trying
my
to make?
My clear point was there was a time when I
he's got the potential
to be one of the major players moving forward. He was showing that in the lights, and you kind of thought, okay, he's going to be a factor, and then he hasn't been. And so
that
you never know
like
when one of those guys.
And when he rode the lights class, it was like 5 years ago.
Yeah,
yes, it was a long time ago.
Yeah, he did have some brilliance there, but – That was a long time ago.
On his day, he smoked everybody at some point. I remember him and Villopoto in the outdoors. Since then, he's come and gone and up and down.
Yeah,
but
well, I mean, look, when he was riding on that team, then he had the superior
bike
over anyone. He was a young kid coming up. I mean, he had a lot to prove. And, you know, obviously he's – you know, I just don't – everyone else is way as equal to or better than him now.
Well, that's why I say he's not even on a dark horse list for me, but – he is going to be there.
But I wouldn't bet against him because he's the kind of guy who gets a whole shot and goes, you know what? I'm feeling it tonight.
Yeah,
he
you
can
know
put
what?
On the
that,
box.
That
he can put
happen.
On the box.
That can certainly happen at Anaheim because we've seen a lot of guys win Anaheim.
Crazy stuff.
Mm-hmm. That are not even contenders for the title. I mean, not even anywhere near that. I mean, we've seen a lot of great history at Anaheim too, but we've seen a lot of crazy races from
like,
that race.
Like, who's your pick if you got to go Porcel versus Alessi?
Porcel, 100%.
Are we talking a fight or?
Sorry, I feel bad, but I mean, obviously, Alessi has almost everybody on the
whole
shot.
There's a heck of a lot more guys on this.
No.
List
we're gonna get to the good
about.
Guys. We're gonna get to those guys, but I'm just
saying.
But
you guys, we just talked about how much a bike changes in 1 year. I mean, Porcel's been out of the Supercross game for what 5 years? I mean, what's he's gonna come back to Supercross, and you guys think that he's just gonna be like?
Well, Dan's starting
from
high
standards.
He started from 800 and 377.
Yeah.
We're going down.
Okay.
Let's get to the double digits, and then we'll get single.
Let's start talking about the Bogle. Let's just get into the Bogle, Tickle, Millsaps level kind of characters that we're going to be dealing with. So that's what I want to do. I didn't want to stick on the top guys. We're going to spend a lot of time on them.
Let's get to Bogle.
Legs whack. Dan's been waiting for this.
Let's
all right, you know what? Hey, before we go to the new guys, let's go to the some of the veteran guys, right?
The Braytons.
Let's go with Reed.
Oh, Reed.
He's got a new bike. He's got a new team, right? We didn't see a lot
from
him. At Monster Energy Cup, but there's a lot of people that want to see him ride well.
What's the team? Yeah.
Right? He's the veteran guy out there. He's riding a Yamaha. He's Monster sponsored, obviously, and he's factory Yamaha. I think he's out there by himself. He's the one rider on the team.
I won't mention names, but I did hear that because, obviously, as you can imagine, Chad's trying to get as much money from himself personally, and Yamaha's trying to offset that. So he might actually be under the Rock River Yamaha rig. Seriously.
Okay. All right.
So it might not
be
a
factory Yamaha.
Wow. He's on factory
equipment.
He has
a factory Yamaha.
Yes.
He might not be out of a rig.
No, he'll be out of a rig.
I feel like
the
South
he might not be out
like
of the solid blue rig. Okay. All right. Well, all right. Enough of that, then. What about Stewart?
No,
we're
going to
start
saying,
with the old guys. We're going to go to the young guys.
I think Chad is someone I would never bet against. I would never place
He'll
a serious
pay
amount of money.
As soon
exactly.
as you bet against him, he will make
I
you
wouldn't,
pay.
I wouldn't bet on him this year, but I wouldn't bet against him either. I don't know with Chad. I think he's in his twilight years. Chad's also a bit of a mental guy. If he feels happy and comfortable, he could win just like a James Stewart or someone. But
I mean,
just don't know. I just feel like you don't know what you're going to get
like
at 34.
He's also one of those guys. If he is on his fitness game, he does perform. There are times where he's
but
like,
he tends
you know,
to ride
a little bit more.
In
listen, I'm here to tell you, and you're probably going to say the same thing, and you and any of us here, at 34, it cannot compete with 24.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I agree with that.
He's got a lot of young guys definitely as fast or faster than he is now. You're right. You cannot bet against Chad Reed because he's strong. He's got the mental game. I mean, he's past champion. He knows how to get it done. And we'd all like to see that once or twice maybe this year, right? I mean, he's
keep it exciting. Yeah.
You know, whether that's going to happen, who knows? But it's exciting. He's on a new bike, new team, you know, stuff like that.
So. Well, he's also on the bike that he won his two titles with. So maybe that puts him back in his happy place. I know talking from him a little bit personally, I think he's kind of kind of happy to be going back to Yamaha. I think he feels like there's a certain special place in his heart with Yamaha. So who knows? I mean, if that really is the case and he gels with the bike, like I said,
another factor. That bike last year with Barcia and Pike got a lot of hole shots. You put Reed up front.
Yeah.
You put Reed different up front. Deal. Could be a different Reed,
that
right?
Bike has that bike has a ton. Those Yamahas have a power. Ton of torque.
He's definitely one of those guys that a little momentum goes a long way with
him.
Now, don't you guys think in 13 and 14, when he had some momentum, that it was some of the fastest Chad Reed we've ever seen?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, he almost seemed ageless at that point.
Not week in, week out. There'd be a couple.
Those times.
He was streaky, real streaky.
And then he'd get, like, it seems when he's at his fastest, have his crash and whatnot. But
I agree.
What's going to happen is these other dudes are going to come and they're going to go, hey, you know, yeah, Reed, your envelope is really big, but I'm going to go outside, so far outside of my envelope, I'm going to ride way outside, and he's not going to want to go there.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah. Guys like Anderson, they'll take him out. Yeah. They'll stuff him.
That's what
they'll take his front wheel out.
That's what age does. Yeah. You know? Yeah. So that's where your 34 can't compete with.
Bogle, your Andersons, those kids that are still trying to really prove themselves as a big dog in the big class, they're not going to hesitate to put an aggressive pass on Chad because they're going to look at it, hey, I'm faster than you, move out of my way. I'm on the way up, you're on the way down. So he's going to lose a little respect from that.
Certainly.
I mean, I think we've all been through that where you're like, really, bro? You're going to come in me like that? You know? But we all go through that.
Tell me a story. Obviously, there's something burning.
But eventually you get used to it because you're like, you cannot change it.
I know. It just always pissed me off. Even if someone got close to me and did a clean pass, it still pissed me off.
Yeah. Where's the respect for the old guys, man?
I'm like, really, bro? Really? You want some? You want some? Off the race, I'm in his face, and then 5 minutes later, people are like, man, you were a bit of a dick. I'm like, I know.
Then later you go home, I'm like, man, I was an idiot.
Man, I would hate me if I had a race against me.
Yeah.
In the real world, 34 is just a pup. But in Supercross world, you know, you're a living legend.
Grandpa.
You know, you're a veteran, and oh my goodness. Yeah, but
it is weird to say that, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I think at 33, that's the magic number where you have to sign up for an AARP card in the Supercross, right?
I think it's earlier than that.
Yeah, it's earlier.
It used to be 30. Now, like, a couple guys are stretching it into their 30s, so we're like, okay, it's 33.
Well, Wyndham kind of ruined that one, right? He stayed out there for a while.
Yeah. Was it Wyndham and Mike LaRocco? Were they about the same age
I think Wyndham was 35 or something.
Caleb's actually a little bit younger than people think. Because he was around.
Yeah, he was
around
for so
long. He moved up to 250s in the 90s.
But I think LaRocco was out there for a while, too.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly what age, but.
You know, and it's because you have so much experience. You have so much knowledge. But I don't know. Why does that happen? Like, why does a body start slowing down? Or is it just
because. If we knew, we could try and fix it, right?
Billionaires. Yeah. Let's bottle it.
It's like age. If we could stop that, we'd be. Super billionaire.
Yeah. It seems like Peyton Manning's found some supplements to
HGH,
help with that.
Baby.
All you haters. You guys are haters. Seahawk fan over here.
Hey, it could be worse. You'd be a Charger fan, right?
Yeah. Hey, I'm a proud Chargers fan always.
Yeah, well, you might be watching games in
LA. Chargers.
I don't think it's going to go down, but that's.
Well, there's been three teams that applied for residency.
But if
all right,
Supercross. All I want to know about that stadium is they going to let us race Supercross in it?
They better.
That would be awesome.
Hey, this is second year of Petco. That's exciting.
Yeah.
That was a great venue.
Yeah.
Yeah, two times this year too.
Second year, and we get two rounds this year.
Hey, who loves San Diego on the West Coast?
Was Petco last year as well?
Yes.
I love it. Yeah.
January 16th, you're going to catch me.
I might have had a headache last year after that one.
I'm going to be stepping. After round two, Supercross.
Matter of fact, I'd like to talk to about the guy where we got to go to break here in a minute. But we'll talk about the guy who won Petco last year, Trey Kinnart.
And let's talk about the next old dude on the list when we come back from break.
We'll do that.
Yep.
Well, let's go to break. Chris, send us a break. Crazy Chris behind the bar. He's got his sombrero going on back there. All kinds of stuff. Dogs and cats. Folks, we'll be right back. The Action Sports Show powered by Toyota Escondido.
Nice. We're getting into it.
It's official. Once again, the truck pros at Toyota of Escondido sold more new Toyota trucks than any other Toyota dealer. That means more smart buyers like you trusted Toyota of Escondido's Truck Center to find them the right truck for work or play.
Toyota of Escondido.
Toyota of Escondido.
It makes sense to buy from the truck sales leader. Let Toyota of Escondido customize your new truck to fit your active lifestyle. Choose from lift kits, custom tires and wheels, and much more. Come experience a whole new way to buy your next truck.
Toyota of Escondido.
Toyota truck sales leader for San Diego County for 2014.
You're listening to Guy Talk, broadcasting live from the Sport Clips Haircuts locker room. Caller, you're on the air.
Hey, boxers or briefs?
Speaking briefly, boxers. Unless you're a boxer, then I'd go briefs. Next caller.
I want to find my nearest Sport Clips. But I don't want to ask for directions.
It's not technically asking for directions if you use sportclips.com to find your nearest Sport Clips location, and no one will ever know. Let's take a break for a word from our sponsor, Sport Clips, where guys go to get an awesome haircut while watching sports on TV. Throw in our relaxing massaging shampoo and our legendary hot steam towel, and you've got our MVP haircut experience. Your head will be as majestic as a freshly mowed major league outfield. Try it today. Last caller, you're on the air with Guy Talk.
So how cool is getting a haircut at Sport Clips?
Oh, it's like stepping up to the plate and slam dunking a touchdown. That's all the time we have today. This has been Guy Talk, brought to you by Sport Clips, where it's good to be a guy.
Hey, this is Dean Wilson, and you're listening to the Action Sports Show.
You're on, guys.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Action Sports Show, powered by Toyota Escondido Action Sports. It's our big Supercross preview special super panel here on the Action Sports Show tonight. I'm one of the hosts, Jim Holtis, Lorette Nickel, Grant Langston, Diana Dahlgren, Jeremy McGrath, and Zero Time. It is Dan McGranahan. And speaking, we just heard about our buddies at Sports Clips. Did you go for an MVP today? Because you're looking awful slick.
Yeah, I slid in there last night with a stylist named Elizabeth. She was handled it. You know, they have this thing there called the tea tree oil. Diana.
Stop. I can't even handle it.
Did you get the double MVP, Dan?
I went double MVP with Liz, and it was awesome. And they have this thing called tea tree oil shampoo. I'm just saying, the cut is amazing. The treatment's stellar, but the shampoo is legit. You got to try it.
Did it make your scalp feel
I have
fresh?
Not yet. I will.
Yes.
Did it make it tingle?
Nice and fresh.
Very much.
I like it when
still
my head,
beaming.
I like it when my head tingles.
Tingles for like extended tingle. Extended tingle.
It's a two-day tingle.
Yes, minimum.
It takes 2 days to tingle.
Quickly.
Sweet.
All right.
Anyway,
so really
well, good job, Dan, on your getting your ears lowered there.
Looking good. What was her name again?
Elizabeth.
She's up in the Red Hawk.
She's the Raider hater. Yeah. No, she's the Raider hater in not Red Hawk, but
well, then I like her.
Winchester.
Oh, yeah, I like it too.
I like her.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
so
she's a lot of fun.
Supercross.
Back to Supercross. We were talking about Chad Reed. We're going down the list of the old dudes. So coming back to Supercross, the return of James Stewie Stewart. He's suspended by the AMA for, what was it, 18 months? He wasn't able to return back to Supercross till 2016 season.
That was rough. That was really rough time as a fan.
Not for me. Sorry.
Well, okay, so we know how you feel.
Thank God.
But hey, hold on. Let's keep it real.
Sorry.
I've had this argument with a few people. When you sign up, they educated everyone what was legal, what wasn't, what the procedure was. I even went and stood just to listen in because I was curious what was going on. They handed out a little pamphlet that literally was like 5 pages. It was very, very, very easy to know commonly used drugs that are banned. And at the top there for amphetamines, it said commonly used drugs such as, first one on the list was Adderall.
Yeah.
So people said 18 months is harsh. You signed a for your license to get a professional license. You agreed to follow the rules. He didn't follow the rules. you got 18 months, which is the least amount of time that you can be banned from a sport from the governing body, which is with them was WADA or USADA, whatever.
WADA.
One of them, anti-doping. But you know, these things have come into our sport. You got to face the music, right, MC? I mean, if you sign up for that and you don't follow the rules, you got to face the consequences. It sucked to see him out, but I mean, who do you blame?
I just don't like.
You can't blame the sport. I disagree with blaming the sport.
You blame James.
Yeah, blame
yourself. It all could have been fixed if he had gone to the sanctioning body and gone.
No, it wouldn't have. They would have told him you can't use that because everyone tries to use it.
Yeah.
That's how half the kids through college are graduating.
That's
is on
right.
Adderall.
That's right.
And they just said no. There's an alternative, which they've done with collegiate sports such as baseball, basketball, football. So I think that was one of those where, to be honest, I think they thought, you know what, if we were to get busted or something happened, we'll just plead
deal
the fifth.
With it then.
I'm sorry.
I think we
and we'll be okay.
I think you could take 20 people and have 20 different opinions.
For
but
sure.
What do we think of him coming back?
I think he's
let's
done.
Let's get on topic.
I think he's done.
Let's get on topic here.
I think he's done.
We didn't see the James Stewart we had hoped probably at Monster Energy Cup. Everyone was hyping him up like he was going to come out swinging like that. He had a terrible weekend, probably one of his more terrible ones throughout his whole career.
Right.
His
is everyone thinking for A1? I mean, I don't know.
His 2014 season was by far, like, not a good season. Sorry.
He's one crash away from sitting on the couch again.
Yeah, no. He wads it constantly. And then not only that, he continues to wad up other great racers, injuring other racers.
True that. True that.
It is what it is. James Stewart, sorry, pal, if you're listening, but
he's a casualty, huh?
Not so much.
Casualty of time, or casualty of the sport?
Look what happened at Monster Cup crash. He went to Europe to race Percy. And I'll be honest, when I watched that crash with him and his brother, I felt like that was the fakest crash I've ever seen in my life. He rode up the berm, stopped, fell over, and all of a sudden he looked like his ankle was broken.
He didn't have to go to Australia anymore.
Exactly. And to me, that is a sign of either he really is injured, which I'm not buying, because you don't ride like Superman and then all of a sudden tip over and you can't walk. I'm not buying that. I think it's here, and I think James has talent, but I think personally, I think he's done, meaning
his heydays are over.
Well,
I mean, the things that he used to be able to do and his ability and his talent and all those things that he used to be able to do, there's no gap now.
Yeah.
He's not that much better, or
exactly.
If at all, he's not as good as the kids now. He's older. Those things just don't happen like they do used to. Like they used to happen, right?
Hey, I mean, straight rhythm's one thing.
His MO throughout his whole career, we've all been a fan of his at one time or another, right? So his MO through his career have been to be a quick to quit.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
He's had some big crashes, but he does bow out fairly often.
And now he's got more injuries, niggling injuries, but more excuses and more reasons why.
I think you're wrong there.
Let him finish.
Well, I think he's wrong.
But he can still finish his thought.
No. If you think someone's wrong, you are free to interrupt at any point in time. In
Zero
the show.
Time has an opinion here, okay?
The
and,
two.
What is your opinion?
I think that he's actually in a healthier place than he's been in a long time because of all the time off. I think 18 months for his body to recover is something that he hasn't had in 15 years.
I think 18 months put him in dormant.
He wasn't injured. That
hibernation.
That puts you in
dormant. Winter's over, bro.
It gave you that time to actually, like, your true.
No, I disagree.
Your true.
Those
true
are 18 precious
recovery.
Months you've lost.
Two or three months, I would say, is a good recovery
either.
Time if
yeah.
you have a knee or something like that, but 18 months
is aging.
That's two seasons.
That's aging.
These
yeah.
kids have
You've
only
lost.
Yeah. They're already caught up.
Has 18 months is like 7 years in Supercross.
It's dog years.
It's yeah. dog years in Supercross
yeah.
are the same thing.
So
totally.
if you had to throw $1,000 on Reed or Bubba, which one would you
Reed.
Do?
Reed, 100%.
For
are we talking about the season?
Are you
whether
upset?
They're going to be like
A1,
8th and 9th or
A1.
6th and 7th or 4th and 3rd.
Best.
Hey,
best.
Isn't it ironic that Zero Time is calling the shots right now on Stewie?
Here's what I would say. If I had to put money on one of the two of them at the start of the season, I would put it on James.
Yeah, James is the kind of guy who comes out guns a-blazing.
Oh, James.
And then wads it.
Yeah.
Guns are blazing. Doesn't Chad and normally take the section,
some
and
rounds
takes out
to get
players
up to speed?
I might take your 1,000 bet on the series, but I think round one, James might come out a little hotter in round one.
He's going to crash.
Well, I mean, like, well,
that's inevitable.
It's checkers or records.
whoever mentions Red Bull Straight Rhythm was pretty much spot on. Oh, yeah, okay, Grant.
After that, everyone's like, he's back. Yeah, he's going to win. I said, James has that natural talent. He can go in a straight line very well and scrub just a little bit better than everyone, and he did just enough. But I said, Monster Cup will be a test. 3:10 lappers. This is intense. It's with everyone. Let's see how he does. He showed me there, in my opinion, that this is the beginning of the end.
Yeah.
Well, I think we can wrap it up with that because I think you might be right.
Thanks, Jeremy.
Let's go on to the 41.
At least he didn't interrupt me.
Let's go on to the 41. I mean,
Trey Kinnaird.
Man, if that guy can keep it together healthy for a season, it's going to happen.
You're right, Jim, but how many years have we been saying that?
It's been way too many years. It's never happened, and he's getting older too.
However, he won 3 rounds last year.
Yes. And faster than, I mean,
he's fast as lightning. I mean, the kid is amazing.
I'll get some hate mail for this one, but he's also got to realize that you can't just go for any gap and think the Lord's going to save you.
I don't think he does.
I'm just going to go for it because the Lord will keep me safe. And at times I've even thought, man, I mean, I just have a different opinion on
that. I mean, I saw a couple more times of that last year.
I don't think he thinks physically. I think that
I don't know if
no
he's
matter
notorious
what happens.
For that.
I can't really picture what – did he have a – he had a practice crash that took him out, right? It wasn't in a race.
No,
wasn't
it wasn't.
Last year it was
when he landed on Weimer.
Yeah, that took him out. He landed on Weimer.
No, that was the big one. That was it 2 seasons ago, right?
No, that was last season.
Yeah, Weimer. In the rhythm section. Yeah. That's right.
He either gets landed on lands on someone like
2 years ago was the big one. Yeah. And last year was the one where it was in a rhythm section.
How many years ago was it with Morris?
It was two years ago,
right?
That one was 13.
That was the scary one.
Yeah, that was
Morris.
The big one. Yeah.
I mean, he's had a major crash every single. It's the kid who has the gray thunderstorming cloud just following him around everywhere. But I will say.
But that's why I disagree. That's why I just said what I said, which I'm going to get hate mail for.
You are. I'm going to send you
because
a hate mail.
Because there's mark
Should
my
we
words.
Give him your mailbox address?
What's your address?
I don't get me wrong. I love Trey Kinnaird. I think anyone, Jeremy, you know Trey.
He's awesome.
He is an amazing kid. You cannot help but
I
like him.
I root for that guy, man.
And I think a lot of people do. I mean, I know family like riders' moms that just like him because he's a genuinely nice kid, and I wish him all the best. But you've got to stop taking big risks. It's in your hands. You can't jump between 3 guys and think that someone's going to part the seas for you. You know what I mean? You're going to land on someone if they're right in front of you.
Well,
and
I mean,
you can't go 17 rounds doing that.
That's been his fault. His decision making's been terrible at times.
I agree.
If he can get out and ride by himself, he's fast as lightning, right? But
on his day, he's untouchable.
Yeah.
I think a big thing for him as well is his starts. If he is it comes down to that with every single rider, honestly. But, you know, last season what we saw before his injury, he couldn't quite get his starts right. But when we do see him get a start, he typically takes a win. So
that's
his biggest key.
He wastes most of the race passing all the dudes that he has to make up for those starts.
It's pretty simple. If he stays healthy, I would say he could legitimately win the title. But I hope he stays healthy, but I just – He's shown us that he can't stay healthy for isn't it 17 rounds? I think it's 17.
I thought there was 16.
No, it's 17 rounds.
17.
Now he's a guy out of the gate that I'd put in contention. He's a guy out of the gate that I'd put in contention for A1.
I would agree. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
He's always a contender
without
for
a doubt.
The podium.
I mean, I think Anaheim 1 is one of those things where for a lot of us, I mean, we've seen in the past. I mean, who would have predicted, what was it, 4 years ago when Josh Grant came out and won? I mean, who predicted that? Nobody, except
that
maybe
was
his
like
mother.
6 years ago.
But you know what I mean? Like, no one would have guessed that. Yeah. Was it that long?
That was like 6 or 7 years ago.
It wasn't. Oh, it was 2009. You're right.
It was 100% like 6 or 7 years ago.
Well, so what? It was so crazy that it even happened. It's still being talked about.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
No, totally. And well, then he got, what was it, second in Phoenix? And then we thought, oh, my God, Josh Grant is
going
to be a contender for 2009. And then after that, just.
You know what that reminds me of?
Ever since.
Ken Roczen.
Oh, you guys, are we going to talk about that contender right now, or are we going to save him for one of the last
ones? Okay, we'll save it.
Well, we
when or we do we want to go back? Contender to kind of wild card, contender to wild card.
We're going contender, pretender, contender, pretender.
I think we just
we have this new crop.
Pretender.
We have this new crop, the Seelys, the Roxans, the Andersons.
I beg to differ. You're putting Roxan in with Seely and Anderson.
Roxan will be lucky to hold on to Seely this year.
Oh. And Anderson.
Oh, I don't think so.
Hold on a second. This is Seely and Roxan's second season in 450. This is Anderson's
the
second
year.
They're
all
okay, all the same.
They're all sophomores.
They're all sophomores. All right. Yeah. All right.
Sophomores.
Yeah, but
you got me on that one.
But you got Roxan. No, actually, is it Roxan's third year? Wasn't he on KTM 1 and then he switched over?
No. No, because he was 250 on KTM.
Yeah, no, he was because
no, he
Andy
was.
Short beat him.
And Dungey, it was one of those things where Dungey and him were battling heads. So this is his third season on the.
You got him too.
Hey, you guys, look, Miss Soupy just scooped. Yo, yeah. Okay, so anyways, sorry.
Five time.
Anyways, so.
My mind's bogged down with the racing.
Let me just. So
years.
we have Roxan. Okay, let's touch on Roxan. You want to go there next?
I thought Bosses? You wanted to save him.
Would you?
I thought I did, but he said contender to pretender to contender to pretender.
I don't understand, to be honest, the hype around Seely. I even saw on Racer X the other day, you know, who's your favorite to win, and it was Dungey, and second was Seely.
You know that he was third
like
in the
Cole
championship
Seely.
Last year,
I don't
right?
care. I would bet $1 million he doesn't win the title. He's not a champion.
Why?
I just do not believe it.
That. He doesn't
you?
Put that off at all.
I like Cole. He's probably going to hate me when he hears this, but he will not win the championship.
You're a mean
not
person.
I know what you're saying, though.
Wait,
he puts
why,
it
though?
Off like he's a – not even – like he's not the guy and
Cole
never going to be the guy. But his results show different, and his speed is legit.
I think he is one of those invisible
he's
guys.
He's going to win a race maybe.
That's right. MC's shaking his head yes up and down. Thank you.
He's not a champion, though. He's not a champion. I think
invisible.
He could win a race, but he's not a super.
He won a race last year, yeah.
But I'm just saying, he's not a champion. There's something
he's
that
proven
is missing.
To be well. He's proven to do really well when
the
he's
pressure's
out, when
off.
He's out front.
When the pressure's off.
When he's riding through the pack.
But when the nails come to it, he cannot handle it.
Hey, man, let's just put fact against fact. He's made less mistakes than, say, Tomac.
True.
Less mistakes than Kennard.
Yep.
Roxan.
Less mistakes than Roxan.
He might finish higher up in the points.
Maybe he hasn't
had
the lightning speed of some of those guys.
He's more of the Dungey model.
Yeah, he is. He's more of the Dungey model. He's more consistent.
Yeah, but
he's
Dungey,
persistent.
Nah, but you can't even compare them. I disagree with that. Dungey gets it done. Seely doesn't.
Yeah, but remember Filippotto.
It's Seely's second year. Dungey's had 5 years. This is. I mean, it's
yeah, but look at the credentials. Even if you back up 3 years. Seely's won a race, like Anaheim won on Troy Lee Honda. He won. Yeah. And you're like, oh, wow. And everyone's like, yeah. And then as the season went on, you know, he was a podium, fourth, fifth.
But I would have to say and believe that since his 250 days, he was very sporadic, right? I mean, he went Anaheim,
he's gotten
won,
more consistent.
And then, yeah, he's definitely gotten more strong for an overall season. Whether he's a title contender, I don't know.
But Dungey didn't have as much competition his first 2 years in the 450 class as there is now.
There was no competition because Filippotto was there. There's no other competition.
There was the disseminator that just was destroying everybody and not much else going on.
That's one thing that – and I'm really sorry. I've always wanted to say this.
Well, let's give Dungey a little credit. Everyone says how Filippotto ruined him. But the year when Filippotto broke his leg, Dungey won the title. It was him and Dungey. You know.
You cannot knock Dungey. He's been there.
No.
And last year, he proved all those other years he was the man. And
absolutely.
Last year's title, like, cemented it because he came out and whooped everyone. And he came from the back. He came from the front.
He
came from all over.
Yeah.
And he won a lot of races. And he was stronger and faster. And his speed was there. I mean, you cannot.
Someone said it earlier.
You can't go against that.
He put all the pieces of the puzzle together. And his puzzle looks great right now. Yep.
Yeah, well, when you take six wins, like, puzzles together.
Yeah.
There we go.
Yeah. So what's your opinion of Roxan?
My opinion of Roxan. All right, we're jumping back to Roxan.
You say you want to touch on him or you wanted to touch him?
No, I don't want to touch on him or touch him.
You said you wanted to touch
him. No, let's touch on him.
I would like your
opinion. I think with Roxan, if he can keep – I think what has really messed him up is he had a trainer, dropped the trainer, was training with Dungey, switched teams. You know,
training
him and Dungey no longer pitted. Yeah, training facilities are completely different. Goes back to his dad's style of training. I mean, he has just been pounded in with all this information from Baker's training camp to now going back to his OG style of training, which was his father's.
Which has proven to not work because he was squirrely last year, right? I mean, at times.
Right, totally.
He was fast. He'd win some, lose some, crash all over the place. But what's the story we all hear as fans of the sport? What's the story that we hear of, you know, the team, some of the team drama and all that?
The letter to the dad.
Have they gotten all that cleared up yet? Is it coming into the year?
It doesn't feel like a real secure situation. Hey,
let's be honest. Where there's smoke, there's fire. So when dad makes that comment.
What's the comment?
You didn't hear about
it? Well, not only is his dad, what was the crazy girlfriend years before that he had? That was just really crazy in the trailer, you know?
Well, I introduced them, but that's a different story.
You're an idiot.
Good job, Grant. Yeah,
thanks.
Good job.
Hey, but he won when they were
way
together.
Way to go, buddy.
I mean, way to go on that. He might not have known it. He was sharing her, but, I mean, at least it was when he races.
That was messed
up. Well, let's talk about racing. Competition's one thing, I guess, but
we are a radio show.
There was
still
a lot of competition at that time. Anyway.
Whoa! Look at how Langston.
So what about
just
what about the team
Langston's
thing?
Ready to like a tell-all book.
Do we think it was truth?
Do we think he's got it ironed out? Do you think he's going to be head right, ready to go for Anaheim 1?
I think that he is a young rider. I think that coming up, he's had his dad his whole life. Then he switched up the program, comes to America, switching all these different options. And I think that he's trying to figure out, okay, what used to make me win all the time? My dad did. The Suzuki did. Let me just go back to these things that kind of feel like home.
I can relate a little bit to that because I think I went through a little bit of that too, you know, with Supercross and just teams and who do you sign with? What do you do? What's the way to go? Because, you know, like Jeremy said earlier, if you talk to 20 people, you get 20 different opinions, and it's so easy to get lost. And I do believe there were some hiccups because I'm pretty good friends with his, you know, Roxanne's ex-mechanic, Kelly. You know, we grew up in Durban racing together as kids in South Africa. And, you know, he kind of said some little more intimate details. And he left the team. He went back to KTM. And he had just said, hey, you know, you can put a bunch of people in a rig and sponsors and that, but when there's not the atmosphere, not the correct people doing the right things at the right time, I mean, we all know you got to do all the little things. And I do think there were some kinks in the armor. And where they've got it sorted out, I think they tried to downplay old man Roxon's interview. And I think old man Roxon probably just thought, I don't give ze, you know what, I'm going to say what I think. And he did. Absolutely. And he got it off his chest.
His dad's
and
French.
German.
it's close French, enough. Though. It was European. It was close enough. Vivo Vin. And I think for this year, I do believe that behind the scenes, you know, everyone hit the panic button and try to keep everything cool, calm, and collected. I do believe they've made some changes. I do
for
think
sure.
things have been ironed out. Whether they have them all sorted out, who knows? We always say, and I actually heard it the other day, and I like the saying, Mike Tyson said, everyone's got a plan until they get punched in the mouth. And it's the same thing. You come to Anaheim, there's 10 guys that think they can win this title until they get smoked.
Yeah,
that
exactly.
Until they get their ass handed to them.
Two. Exactly.
Yeah, there's 10 guys. I got this. I feel good. I've been in the best shape of my life. I'm on the best bike with the best mechanic, with the best trainer. And then after Anaheim 1, F this, screw that, I'm
bike
over
sucked,
it. I need a new team.
Well, to
my pants don't fit.
To Diana's point, though, you know, I would think that the best Roxon we've seen yet is when he was on KTM, when he was with Baker. Mm-hmm. And now he might also have a little bit of hesitation knowing that Dungey has the bike he probably wants. You know, because, you know, as you made a point, you know, you can relate. You don't know where to sign. You think of all the things when you're a kid, like, oh, that was way better. And, I mean, it was a long time ago that he rode Suzuki's, right?
Yeah.
He was young.
Up.
He was 15, 16, right? He basically grew up riding a KTM. And then he probably thought, oh, well, you know, I'm going to go back to Suzuki. And it's probably not been everything he ever imagined it was when he was a kid because it's just, you know, it's always different.
Also, I think it was a tough spot to be at KTM. You got to imagine you got two big egos, two guys that believe they should win. They want to be the number one. And I think Roger DaCosta was trying to also do the balancing act of keeping everyone happy. And I feel like that was just one of those things that was boiling that you knew something was going to change. Someone was going to leave or something was going to happen. And I think Roxon did what he thought was the best for him. And I think he realized it wasn't all – the grouse wasn't as green as I thought it was.
I don't think he would have left if it wasn't for the money.
I think he got paid crazy
money. He got Jeremy McGrath
money to go to this new team right here. And, like, crazy money. And that really plus the fact of what you're saying that he was always going to be the number two rider at KTM. He was and now he's the number one focus.
He's undisputed number one at KTM. There wasn't really a number one.
I think looking at it now and just me and you, you've been through this. There's some advantages to not being the lead guy on the team.
Yeah.
I would have been fine. Pay me the same as him, but let him take all the glory. I'm fine with that, but I'm going to smoke him, right? I mean, that's what I would think.
But if you keep smoking him, he's not going to get all the glory.
And he won't be the number
fine.
One.
That's fine, but, you know, it's
at that point, you don't care.
Perception is reality, right?
I mean, well, it's all in how you take it, the mentality, right?
All Points Bulletin, Jeremy McGrath has no idea what it means to be the number two person on a team.
That's so true.
Hey, you know, at some point, at some time, hey, you could even argue, what about 93? I mean,
right.
Stanton.
Right.
Stanton was the guy.
Yeah.
You were the dog horse. You were
that kind of guy. And look, it took me three rounds, which not very long, but I was fourth and fifth the first two rounds, and then I won a race. So, I mean, even up to the third race, it really was like, you know, he's the new kid. And I had no idea if I could even see the podium until it actually happened, right?
And then once it happened –
yeah, then it's I had a hard time getting second. But
yeah, exactly.
You know, it happens. I don't know.
But when you have two riders, you know, you're coming into a brand new season. Are there team orders that?
No.
So I mean, he had access to some of the greatest equipment.
Sure.
You know,
no doubt. It just gets in their heads a little bit.
I don't think it was necessarily Roczen too, because if you guys know Roczen, you've talked to him, you know, he's a nice kid. He gets along with everybody, even in weird, awkward situations with, like, you know, social, you know, awkwardness or whatever. He's always been great socially. I think it was the number one rider on KTM, Ryan Dungey, who is the social awkward one, who made it awkward in the trailer, who was the quiet one, who probably didn't want to be his friend when he won A1 and Dungey didn't get up on the podium at A1 last year. It just is what it is. The top guy who's, you know, has all the pressure to be winning A1 and also has a teammate who's like, you know, oh, he could be a number one contender too. You know, Dungey probably mentally didn't sit well with that. And that definitely 100% and 1,000% sure projects with Dungey anywhere he goes when Roczen was on the team with him.
I felt like when they were teammates, it was like the Cold War.
Yeah.
You know, there really wasn't like missiles being launched at each other, but it was just like this stagnant, awkward.
They each had a button.
Yeah, like – yeah, getting ready to hit the panic button.
If it was legal to, like, shame someone, like, Dungey would have full-on just, like, walked past Roczen and just, like, did a little right there and killed him. Like, I totally think that.
I do think Roczen, for not being American, for not being from California, he is the most California kid American that we have out there. Like, from a personality standpoint,
he crushed it.
Well,
he also traveled a lot. He raced a lot in America, and I think – he was one of those kids that was his goal, was to be in the States. You know, I think several
guys. He's a young Grant Langston, isn't he?
He wanted a party.
He's in line with the Langstons and McGraths.
He wanted to talk about the nipple game on the tires.
Real personality.
That's what he wanted to do.
And it was it's a big plus because it's desperately needed within our sport.
Yeah.
No.
His personality.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he's good for the sport.
Well, the problem is so many of the guys, you know, when I grew up, I used to watch, you know, MC and Emig and all these guys in the videos. I'm like, oh, that's so sick and cool. And the problem is, well, I say problem, it's my problem, I guess, but it's gotten very intense and serious nowadays. So a lot of these kids are homeschooled, so they are socially awkward. They don't even know how to do an interview. They don't know how to talk to people. They're like socially retarded. And then, you know, they do well at motocross.
They really
are. And
then, totally agree.
And then all of a sudden, there's some Miss Supercross chick all over them, and they get hugged up, and they got a model, and then things go sideways. And hopefully he keeps it clean.
I will tell you this, Langston, 100%, all that is true. I will tell you, like, I did an interview out at the Doonies, right, because we did the CBS Behind the Special, whatever. And I'm getting asked these questions, and I'm like,
were you the one with the thong on?
Stop. It's not a thong. It was booty shorts and my
backside.
And
you hiked them up big time.
No, my backside just tends to do that for some reason. It's the way my body is built. Anyways.
Oh, nice one. Goodness.
So during this interview, we're getting asked all these questions, right? And I'm telling the interviewer, you know, the biggest thing that motocross is missing, what I grew up watching is, you know, music, chicks, great time. It looked like a blast. Supercross, motocross, freestyle was coming in the mix when I was growing up, it looked like a grand old time. That's what attracts a lot of people to supercross, motocross, all that stuff, right? So here you have Dunies where, you know, we're bringing that back, essentially. Like you're saying, yeah. Supercross becomes so hardcore. These athletes get up on the podium, they're pissed, they're angry, they don't know how to talk right, they don't know how to talk on camera, they don't know how to show their personality. You have Roczen come in, who's this young gun, happy-go-lucky, even when he's pissed.
You can blame all that on Carmichael and Alton Baker, though.
Yeah. Well, so thanks,
Boo.
Go. But yeah, it's like these, a lot of these athletes now, like these younger guys, they're all what, 19, 20, 21. They're watching, while I was watching MC, they're watching GOAT. And now they think it's like all about seriousness when really you just, sorry.
Stop it.
Not GOAT.
Just
but,
kidding.
But, you know, Carmichael.
Thought he was here.
But yeah, that's the biggest thing about Supercross. I think that's probably Supercross would be, they would probably have a lot more successful riders in the mix if only they had a brain.
Well, and if the host would just ask them questions better than
how you feeling out there tonight?
You haven't won in over 2 years. How do you feel right now?
I want to punch faces. I'm serious. When I hear how does it feel to win the LCQ? How does it feel to win this main event? Think of something better.
Yeah, but as lame as that is,
personality like.
Yeah,
God.
But as lame as that is, it's just as lame when they go, oh, yeah, it was good. I got to thank my bike, blah, blah, blah. You're like, what?
Jeremy, it has been my number one complaint about Supercross.
That pisses me off, is the pit board reading.
No, honestly, you guys, it has been my number one complaint. I think I've talked about it all three or four shows in a row since I've been here, that the worst thing that these athletes can do is actually watch what everybody else is doing, because then it's just robotic. Yeah, you know, every rider starts their sentence with, yeah, you know, my bike was running real well.
For sure.
I just want to thank blah, blah. Give
for
me
sure.
something. Give me something, please, for the love of all that is good and
I
holy.
I can tell you, I'm as big a fan of as this sport as anyone, right? But when the interviews come on, I walk away.
Well, here's why.
I got to pour myself a fresh drink.
Yeah. We need – this is what we need. We need Travis Preston back.
We need Matt Walker as well.
Travis Pastrana is good too.
Yep.
We need
Super
these guys
pumped.
That
Super
will come
pumped.
Back.
Yeah. Up.
That'll. I'll take that, though.
For doing like, the interviews?
No, maybe. But
well,
get out
he could
there
be the
and
interview
actually,
and the interviewee.
He would be a good interviewer too.
They will actually get out there and
– if I was a sponsor, I'd be mad for if you said my name on there. Because if you're getting interviewed, they know who you are.
Isn't it written in the sponsorship agreement?
Some of them are, yeah.
You have
to say,
thanks to my energy drink, thanks to my tires, yeah. Thanks to my blah, 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 blah. It has to be mentioned. And so these kids who have some sort of story to tell about why it was so difficult on the track have to mention their
tires. There's a few ways you can do it. You know, you don't have to just go, I need a thank.
Wyndham was perfect.
Blah, blah, blah. They go, oh, well, it was a great night. Got off a good start. You know, Dunlop tires. Picked
Wyndham
the right
did
compound,
it really well.
Something. The bike handled good. That car, he just, you know, was on form tonight. We got it dialed with the crew. My gear was, I don't know, just make it sound a little more normal.
Well, you know, when you were working at Arena Cross and, you know, you got to interview the athletes, was it ever something before? I mean, did you do a live announcing or TV? Sorry.
The TV. But the nice thing with Arena Cross, I felt because it wasn't as corporate.
You know everything else. What happened there?
I was going to say, you are a walking encyclopedia this evening.
Yeah.
How'd you not know
until that happened.
Yeah.
I forgot. I was at Supercross while you were at Arena Cross.
Oh.
Ouch. Now this year,
that was
you're
her
at
way
Supercross.
Of saying, I'm kind of a big deal and you're not.
Yeah.
Okay? We'll keep it simple.
He's in motocross now.
This year you're going to be at Supercross and I'm going to be
Yeah, now I do outdoors, so I work twice as hard.
Man.
For half as much?
Yeah. No, outdoors are great. It's just the travel.
And
well,
what do you
mean?
That's every single weekend.
12 races.
That's every single weekend.
Well, they have a couple
Even during
off.
Supercross. I mean, nah, nonstop.
If you don't, I mean, he's not going to every Supercross, so he has some time off before outdoors.
Oh, okay.
I don't have to
when
go
your
to
season
Supercross.
Ends,
he's hitting it hard on the West Coast series.
Okay. Well, yeah, why not? Because it's fun.
So are we on the older dudes or the younger dudes now?
No, now I think we're
contenders.
Well, Roczen
would be
pretenders.
The younger. Seeley, I said I think he could win a race, but I would bet money he's not going to win a title.
Okay, who's the next one we're going to talk about?
I want to hear you guys' thoughts on this guy right here, Weston Pite.
I was just going to say.
Oh, yeah, he's such an underdog, but he's making, like, solid
gains.
Solid gains.
He's that guy that continuously impresses me. Yeah. I mean, he literally used to come into my store and buy parts when he was a privateer.
Dude, I grew up with him. I went to high school. I was one of his brother's buddies. And he was always the younger one. But
well, the first time I heard of West.
He's going to lose a lot of weight.
He has done
he
that.
Is, yeah. He's it's lost a lot of weight.
It's called hard training, not just partial training. He's training hard now. I swear. I think he's
he's working hard, not hardly training. Working.
Yeah. Yes.
I mean, it's insane the amount of weight that he's
so
had
what
to
do you
shed.
Think about was his racing?
Was he a stocky guy? I mean, he's ripped.
He
now.
Is a stocky
I mean,
guy. But now he's just shredded. He was not. He was an overweight guy, yeah. To be honest.
He's
with
the
you.
Kind of guy, if someone owes you money, I'd send him in there and try and get him as a collection.
That's
yeah, we had him on the show, gnarly dude, you know, running late. You know,
bounty hunter.
Doing a couple hundred exactly. miles an hour here. Let me ask you all this, in your opinion, will Weston win a race this year?
I don't know if he'll win a race. I think that it's if the game is right that night. You know how, like, sometimes just you have a race where the top racers, they, you know, eat it. Like, one and two will wad up with trying to do a pass. And he's third, and he'll make the pass.
He could
and
be
he'll
the
win.
Anaheim 1 winner.
I mean, it's
when
one
no
of those.
When no one picks him and
yeah, it's
goes
one of those.
Haywire. I don't know. I think Weston Pike.
Podium contender.
Belongs in the ocean on the Pacific side. Right? A Weston Pike. I feel like that's something I'd catch off the coast of Catalina
like
or something,
fish.
You know?
That's what you're saying.
Let me go right? catch me a pike.
A Weston Pike.
So where do you see him fitting in? Where do you see him fitting in the results?
What's the prediction?
I see him being on the podium a few times.
Really? In Supercross?
Yeah.
He did get on the podium. Remember, I told you guys that story a couple weeks ago, how Weston Pike for the first time got on the podium.
And he looked good in the, like, Bercy.
And then he was like, first thing he does, walks onto the podium, comes to me, he's like, "What's up?" And I was like, "You're kidding me right now, right? Stop." He gets his first podium. He got third place. And he's just like, "What's up?" And I was like,
"And he thought it was time."
Says he knows
like,
you.
I got it.
No, he was like, "It's game time." He's like, "I made it. Like, I feel like MC right now. Like, what's up, girl?" And I was like, "No, we're good. Thanks."
You're like, "What?"
I'm all swerve.
So we talked about
you're it. You're like, "This might be your first podium, but I've been on the podium every weekend. So five get over five. It, bro."
Right?
Exactly.
So we talked about this a couple weeks ago, Jeremy. Obviously, you weren't here. What's your take? Will he win a race this year?
Pike?
Yeah.
My opinion of Pike is, like, the guy's made incredible gains. And last year I was at Daytona Supercross, and, like, he was crushing the whoops, like, going so fast.
I was
so impressed. I mean, Pike's a guy that, you know, a few years ago you would have been like, who?
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Now he's made these huge strides. He's riding well. I mean, you can see he just wants it really bad. Do I see him winning a race? I don't think so. I think he's,
podiums.
I think
he would need some luck. I think
he's to win. You know, he's a strong guy. He's going to be out there for the duration, I believe. There's going to be some guys that'll have some stuff happen, and he's going to be in the catbird seat, right? As if something happens, he's going to be a guy maybe that could be there to capitalize. You know, I think he's probably a consistent fifth place guy. You know, which is good.
I mean, I think
that's really
fair.
Good. I think it's a consistent fifth. The top guys are going to be mixing it up, and
well,
he could get a podium here and there, but I think fifth.
The flip side is if you're a fifth place guy and you stay healthy, you're probably going to be a podium guy because you're going to lose
and
one or two of
that's
your top
what,
five
that's what
guys
I'm talking
with
about.
Injuries.
They're
going
to shuffle around a little bit.
And then you lose one or two. You're running third or fourth.
Well, that's the thing.
Guy goes
if
down in a race
exactly.
and you're in position.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we've seen that where – you know, a few years ago when Stuart and Reed came together, took each other out, you know, and all of a sudden you get a random winner. Carmichael in 2002, I think. No,
I don't know.
Three.
It's a long time
ago. He went down. You know, a lot of these guys you come and you predict for the first round may put a little too much emphasis on it. Crazy things happen. I could see Pike getting a little bit of luck to win a race, but I don't expect him to be a winner. I think he could be a podium guy here and there. But there's so many good guys.
So you think? So you would say that his results would sit somewhere with you the same way as Cole Seeley, maybe?
Yeah. I think he'll be a little bit more consistent than Cole. Like, I could see, like you saying, Pike being fourth, fifth with a podium, whereas I could see Seeley being crash out here, an eighth there, and a win the next weekend. You
yeah,
know, like, that's what I think with Seeley. Like, you don't really know. He's got the potential, but I just don't think he has the package to put the whole thing together.
Here's a name that came up earlier. A guy never really did what we thought he could in the 450, killed it on the 250s. Jake Weimer coming back from an injury.
Hey, that was it. That was like a total, what's his name, 09 win at A1 story.
Josh
Grant. Yeah, sorry.
His name's the same as mine. I'm sitting around next to you. Grant. It's pretty simple. It's a five-letter word. Starts with a G and ends with a rant.
It's one of those, Weimer is like one of those Grant stories. He came in on his 450 rookie year. He got like, what was it, second his at A1 or something like that. He did better than Filippotto. Filippotto ended up taking fourth. And then, you know, Filippotto's pissed, almost like a Dungy Roczen type thing. Goes into Phoenix, gets third, gets another podium. And then after that, kind of just falls off. And then ever since then, we've never seen him back up on the podium.
I don't – Weimer's at a disadvantage because he doesn't have a team bike probably anymore. He's got a privateer bike, and we won't see him anywhere near at the front, I don't think.
I don't think he'll be a podium guy.
I like
guy.
Jake. He's a good dude, but I just –
It would be a fluke.
He was too stacked
What
these
you're talking
days
about as well, Diana, he was at the right place. He came off Pro Circuit, Mitch Payton, where he won a West Coast Supercross title. He had confidence. He was friends with Villopoto. They trained together. They worked together. He was on a great bike. Without the pressure, like Jeremy said, he was the number two guy. There was no pressure. All the pressure was on Villopoto. And when there was no pressure, all of a sudden he was beating Villopoto. And then it was like, oh, shoot. I'm the leader.
And honestly, Villopoto and him were buddies. So Villopoto is probably the reason he got the ride. Because they work well together and all that. So, I mean, you know, it's gonna be tough.
And I think Villopoto was in no way intimidated by him. He knew.
No.
No, not at all.
Yeah.
So well, guys and gals, we got to go to a break.
Break.
I'll talk about it later.
What other
talk
things?
About it when we come back, and we got all kinds of other people that we haven't even touched on yet. So a lot more to go. Our Supercross preview special, the super panel on the Action Sports Show. We'll be right back.
It's true. The best new cars make the best used cars. And Toyota of Escondido is once again number one in Toyota certified used cars and trucks. Feel confident driving with the peace of mind of a 160-point inspection and Carfax report.
Toyota of Escondido. Toyota of Escondido.
You also get a 12-month or 12,000-mile comprehensive warranty from certified purchase date, plus a 7-year or 100,000-mile limited powertrain warranty from original date of sale when new. Please ask for complete warranty details.
Toyota of Escondido.
Toyota certified sales leader for San Diego County for 2014.
The boys are back with two huge events coming to the Southland. Monster Energy Supercross. Brought to you by Mission Motorsports Irvine. January 9th. It all starts with the season opener. Then follow the action one more time when the best riders take over Anaheim January 23rd, all at Angels Stadium. Get your tickets now at Ticketmaster and participating Yamaha dealers. All seats $5 more to have show prices subject to market demand. Additional fees apply. January 9th and January 23rd only at Angels Stadium.
What's up, guys? This is Donnie from FMF Racing. When I'm not straight out of Compton slinging pipes on the corner, I'm listening to the Action Sports Show powered by Toyota of Escondido.
You're on, guys.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Action Sports Show, powered by Toyota of Escondido. If you're just joining us, this is the Action Sports Show, your one-stop shop for anything and everything in the action sports world each and every week. And this week, it's Supercross, baby. We're just a few days away from the kickoff, Anaheim 1, and we've assembled the super panel here today. I'm Jim Holtis, Lorette Nickel, Grant Langston, Diana Dahlgren, Jeremy McGrath, and the man,
Double
Dan
Zero.
McG McGranahan. So we're talking about a lot of different folks here, and we're going to get to some 250s here soon too, because there's a lot of stuff to talk about. But
there's really not a lot to talk about with the 250s. It's Coop Webb, Coop-a-loop. Coop. He's going to do it.
Unless he gets hurt, I don't think anyone will beat him.
I don't think anyone's.
Well, let's wrap up our 450 with the number 51.
We definitely need to talk about Barcia.
Then we all need to get opinions on who's going to take A1 and who's going to take
exactly.
the championship.
Let's get a podium bet.
All right, so what's the deal with Barcia, guys? Number 51, Justin Barcia, came in guns blazing. He is the most aggressive, passionate, persistent, or not maybe not persistent, but aggressive, I would say, number one out of the whole ranks. He's very emotional on the track.
I like his style. I mean, I'll be honest.
Hey, of course you do. You like to shaft.
He reminds me of me a little bit. He's a little out there, you know, but I like it. He always smiles. He rides hard. He's, like some people say, he's over-aggressive or he's this, he's that. I really respect a guy that's not out there just collecting a paycheck, who rides with passion. So I think the outdoors helped him a lot. I think this is just my opinion from riding a bunch of different bikes over the last few years. I think the Yamaha is a very rigid chassis-type bike. So I think it suits guys like Pike better than smaller guys. That's why I think you saw some guys struggling. Like even Millsaps looked pretty good at JGR. And I think for Barsha, he had a tough time because he's a more compact size rider. And I think he battled to get that balance and feeling. And I know that he worked with the guys at Yamaha. One of my old mechanic, Dino Dan, was there. And I know that they worked a lot. And he even said, if we try and loosen this thing up, I think it'll help you. And yeah. They started going down that road. And the confidence just started overtaking. So I think he's coming into the season with a lot of momentum, mentally at least. And just confidence inside.
But wasn't Barsha hot like in the middle of the summer? And then towards the end of the Nationals, he kind of petered, you know,
just,
fell
just
off
the
a
last
little bit?
Round, no. Just the last two rounds. I think he had like a mediocre day the one day and some bad luck.
Yeah, but like Roczen won the last one. But for the most part, there was what, like seven rounds where he like took the win.
He was just the
He was
the
first
guy.
Or second.
Not seven.
He went second, second, second,
sorry,
first,
that's your number.
Second, first, second. In seven
so
rounds.
I think that's definitely something, and momentum with him
seven,
is huge. And
he did win.
He won two,
riding.
But got second five times.
Yeah,
I'm with
good.
You on that, Yami. I was concerned with him getting on that bike because I agree that I feel like it fits the bigger rider, the more upright, that steers the bike with the back of the bike a lot more than these over scrubber
suits
kids.
A pike.
Suits a pike.
A
Will
western
Saps.
Pike, not an eastern.
I was concerned that he was going to over scrub the front and throw it away, like what we saw happen when Bubba got on the bike and. You see a lot with that.
He looked very uncomfortable when he was on the Yamaha.
But somehow, and I really watched Bam Bam a lot. He hangs off the back of that bike a lot. And I think that's, you know, that style of his actually really, really works for that Yamaha. But I was really concerned about it.
I feel like Bam Bam's the kind of guy, if you saw him going down the freeway, he's probably hanging out of his car as well.
Right.
Like he hangs Woo! Out on everything. You know what I mean? Like a puppy with his head out the
Just
window.
Just like you.
I don't – listen, I think Barsha's style, you got to appreciate the passion that you see when you watch him ride. He's a take-no-prisoners kind of guy, that's for sure. We've seen that, right? His downfall has been he mixes it up with too many guys while he's trying to come through the pack if he has a bad start, which for me, knowing what I know and having my experience, you need friends on the track, right?
You don't want to
He
create
has
your
zero
own problems.
Friends.
Yeah.
And when you're in fifth place and you need to get to the front, every guy is going to just be sticking thorns right through your tires, right?
Well, if you're owed.
Exactly. Yeah. And everyone owes this kid. So I find it hard to believe that he can be a streaky rider. He can be really fast. But his downfall is he mixes it up too hard with too many guys and he disrespects too many guys along the way. You know, some of that has mellowed out at times, but it doesn't take much to get him his flame bursting up, right? And he just start railing guys. And
you can certainly
appreciate that, right? He's
it's great
passionate,
for the fans,
right?
But if you're talking titles,
you can't win titles like that, and you can't win week in week out like that either, because too many guys want to just get you.
That's a very valid point. I think Jeremy hit there. I was just thinking for Supercross, I think Barsha will be a little too streaky, like Jeremy said. And the problem is in Supercross, you're always one shift or one pop of the clutch away from being 20th into the first turn. So you're going to have to come from behind a few rounds.
Sure.
And if everyone's got it out for you, and the thing is, if someone – I know from experience, I don't want to speak on behalf of everyone, but if there's a guy I don't like and he's catching me and I know there's nothing I can do to stop it, I'm already irritated.
You.
So, I'm just going to ruin his night as well. So when he comes to pass me, he might pass me. I'm going to brake check him the next corner. I'm going to stuff him. I'm going to hit him. I'm going to try and get in his head and hope that he crashes. But also try and prevent him from moving forward.
That's not nice.
Yeah,
Motocross and Supercross is not nice.
And you know
nice.
What? Like we talked about earlier, the guy that's out front, and if he's a contender as far as speed, he's passing you, and you hang him up for a second or two.
That's so
then
hard
boom,
to catch
he's
up
done.
Nowadays.
He can't even catch up, and you do that every week. I mean,
two seconds and one lap might take someone like him five laps to catch it up, even if you're off
exactly.
faster. So
yeah,
You need the whole package.
I must say though, and throughout the summer, this was a proven fact. Barsha in the past has been you know, he's totally overrode the bike, right? He rides right. the bike way too hard sometimes. And with Budman coming on to help him, like coach him in his riding, I think he's really improved on his bike riding skills. You know, his, like I think he's been a kid that can go very fast, but his bike riding skills have gotten a lot better, a lot smoother and things like that. So that's helped him. Whether that's going to translate into Supercross or what.
There's more of a purpose of what he's doing now. Before, he was just all over the place. Mm-hmm. Now, I think he's actually figuring out how to move that Yamaha around.
I agree. He's making all those crazy movements and all those things that he's done in the past and turning them into forward speed.
And simplifying it,
I mean,
too.
You can just ride yourself and you can look like you're going a million miles an hour and you're not going anywhere. And making the most noise out there, too, and you're not going anywhere. And he was guilty of that forever.
Yeah, we call that going nowhere in a hurry.
That's right.
There's also something to be said for this state mentally that he's in now, because in the past you would see Bam Bam have a flash of brilliance, but then if someone threatened it or he had a bad start or something, you could see him get knocked off his game mentally. During this recent streak that he had, he came out and he started kicking everyone's butt for a while, but then he also had a rough race. But then he just came right back and got back onto kicking people's butt and had a rough one. But he showed the ability to bounce back more so than I've seen out of him in the years past. And
I would
think
agree.
There's a maturity there.
He's a mentally strong kid. I mean, you know, people might bag on him or tell him he's dirty. Like, I've talked to him in private, and, you know, a lot of guys, they might, like, I think someone like Roxon, he gets nervous when he hears, if someone says, oh, you're a dirty rider, like that gets in his head, like, oh, people don't like me, this and that. Bam Bam, I can't repeat on the air, but he doesn't give a, you know what, yeah. what people think. I mean,
doo-doo.
Exactly. One of those. One
but,
of them.
But well, Jeremy, again, that's not in your favor to act.
It's not. But what I'm saying is that's why he can bounce back, because he just has self-belief and he doesn't listen to the chatter and he just does his thing. Like, he is one of those guys that genuinely does not really give a rat's
each
ass
weekend
of what's happening
it's
around
a clean table
yeah
erased yeah
yeah
well I have a question for both of you regarding that. So Jeremy, you were talking about, you know, him being owed because basically he punts riders around
yeah.
on the
yeah.
track. Do riders have a short memory? Would Barcia be able to
no.
make up and rectify that and make friends if he played nice?
Yeah, buy them a Ferrari and then they'll might let you through. That's about
in,
it
in
which
my,
ain't gonna happen
in my opinion.
Damages
a rider in my career, in my day, a rider would have to ride near me a couple times and not act a fool, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, to gain respect back. But there's always this element of, you know, like, hey, I'm riding next to Lusk. I don't know what this guy's going to do, right? Like, is he going to take me out today or is he not? So, you know, it's always a little bit confusing. So there has to be some, like, maybe one, two, three or four incidents where you've ridden next to him, like, okay, cool, I trust this guy again.
Yeah.
You know, but I think he's so hot sometimes and cold that, you know, he's going to go next. He could go next to you three times on the track, and then the fourth one just knock the crap out of you, right?
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that, you know, and along the way, he could hit some other guy, right? I mean, we don't forget those things when you're riding. It doesn't matter if
exactly.
it's 8, 9, 10 rounds the next year. You're like, hey, this guy's a kook. I'm not going to ride next to him. And if he gets next to me, I'm going to take him out.
So to answer your question.
Because it's better him than me.
Riders don't have a short-term memory loss when it comes to that.
Right.
I can remember when someone hit me 15 years ago. And if I get a chance, I will return the favor twice as hard, twice as long, twice as many
even,
times.
Even now?
Oh, absolutely.
Drop yeah. a name. Come yeah. on.
Yeah. See
he's
the guy
like,
on the freeway.
He's like hanging out behind Lynx and Motorsports at Paris Raceway,
you know,
and just punts over at
I think
from
we
15
should get,
years ago.
I'd like to get me, Mike Brown, Travis Pastrana, and Ryan Hughes back on the gate again.
Wow, that's a tough group, man. You're not a scared guy at all.
No, those were some of the craziest times. They were also fun because, like, we hated each other. Like, I did not like – I mean, except for Travis. I never hated Travis. He was too nice off the track to hate him. But on the track, he would smash you in a
ruthless,
heartbeat.
Ruthless, huh?
Yeah. And I did the same back to him. And then off the race, he'd give me that bent thumb up, and I'd shake his hand. And we were always good. We were always good.
You'd be like, yeah,
off
man.
The track.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
Like, I smashed you twice. That was awesome.
He is. He's exactly
let's
like that.
Let's go get a snow cone.
Let's do it again.
Yeah. All right, bro.
You know what's so funny is that Mike Brown is still owed. So Mike Brown, you know,
I know
made
I did
the move
Enduro Cross this year, and I was watching, and I'm like, yep, same old Mike Brown.
Yep. And I was talking to a lot of the athletes, and they're like, yeah, Mike Brown is owed.
Oh, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
So he's another guy that, like, in his field now that they won't hesitate to throw a little block on him or do anything, and because of, you know, what he's done. And
there's a fine line between being aggressive and just pissing everyone off.
In order to win races and win them consistently, you need acquaintances.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They don't need to be your best friends, but you don't need to wreck everybody either.
Keep your friends close and your enemies even closer.
That's right. I mean, still to this day, I didn't have a lot of guys that I didn't like to ride around. But Emig was terrible, and Lusk was terrible. Those two guys, LaRocco was sometimes kind of bad if you put yourself in the wrong spot. But, you know, those two guys that, you know, I was riding, and I didn't think they had a conscience, you know, and it was just scary. You know, you can always appreciate a guy. Like, I loved racing Wyndham. We had so many fun races, and we would just pass and do all this stuff, and I would never think about taking him out because we had so much fun, and he would respect me the same. You know, and I don't work that way of, like, hating my competitors, you know.
Right.
But I was always very nervous of a few guys.
You know, it's so funny to hear about this from a rider's perspective, because these are some things that we don't typically talk about, you know, on, like, an you know, radio host show, or we talk about this. We usually talk about the stuff we have been talking about, racers, how fast they are, their consistency, their passion, their speed, all that stuff. You don't necessarily hear, well, as a rider, I get nervous about riding around riders A, B, C, and D, and I don't trust this person, this. And to win a race, you actually have to have acquaintances on the track. You don't ever think of that strategy of the race.
Yeah, I mean, as we've talked about tonight so many times, if you're not out in front, this is when this stuff all comes into play. There's so many other factors that
and guess
that
play what? In 17 rounds, you will be out front at some point, and you will be at the back at some point. You know, so it's not. So you got to factor in all these elements. You know, and that's why, going back to what we were talking about earlier in the season, there's legitimately 5-6 guys right now that go, I've got this. I can win the 2016 Supercross, and they believe it. And then when it gets the first race, it then shows who really was doing all the little things right, who really was focused, you know, who's just saying the right things and who really believes it. You see it there. But in a 17-round series, there's a lot that goes on. Most guys are going to have some sort of a niggling injury. I mean, when you're busting laps during the week, and that's the thing people don't see with Supercross, is how much you do away from the racing, what you don't see on TV. So it's so easy to get injured, and so difficult to stay healthy. And when I say healthy, I'm talking about not getting a cold, because I mean, these guys are going to be on airplanes for
wintertime.
Yeah, going to places where it's below zero, yeah. Coming back where it's warm, and in between all this, you're training your butt off, you're doing everything. So it's an adventure, in my opinion, a Supercross series. So just to help people understand, to get through 17 rounds is a huge accomplishment on its own. If you can finish 17 rounds of Supercross, I take my hat off to you, because that is something that not a lot of people have done in their career, let alone win the title.
Yeah.
So that's goal number one. And I think for a lot of people, as you see, it's just a pyramid system. You got a dozen guys right now that are fast, that are excited, that are new bikes, got new gear, they're feeling froggy, they got a little prep in their step, and then that tier system starts, and then guys start fizzling out, you know,
shelled off.
And this guy's got a sprained wrist, he's got a tweaked ankle, this guy's got a niggling injury, this guy had a bike issue, you know, and all of a sudden you're back down to the same couple guys that we probably mentioned at the beginning of the show that'll be there.
Does luck come into play quite a bit?
You need some luck. If you're having bad luck, you're not going to win a title.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but you know what, you make
luck
your own
evens
luck.
It out.
I was just
going to
say,
yeah,
do you make your own?
You create your own luck. If you're acting like a jerk out there on the track, then you're going to get unlucky.
Right.
You know,
if
you have the right etiquette and you're doing all the right things, you know, that is luck, right?
Yeah.
Preparation is luck.
Yeah.
You know?
So here's the deal. We need to get off the 450s. I want to get some
let's get some predictions.
Predictions going. Mm-hmm. Here's what I want. Before we go to break, we got 2 minutes. So I want to get your top three for A1, your top three for the season. Jim, 450s.
Top three at A1. I would say Canard.
What spot?
1, 2, 3. Give me an order.
Yeah, are we starting from the bottom?
I say Trey wins it.
Oof.
Wow.
That was bullshy.
Ballsy.
Man.
And I'm saying, gosh, I don't know. That was quick. I'm going between.
Didn't even give us any time to think about it.
Yeah, I know. I thought we were saving that for the end.
We have been talking for an hour and a half.
You got plenty now.
We're going. 250s next.
I would say, I don't know, Dungy and Roczen somewhere in 2 and 3. I'm not sure on that.
So, okay, but that's not how predictions work. So, Trey, then
Dungy, Roczen.
Dungy, Roczen. Okay. 1, 2, 3. All right. All right. That's fair. Lorette, my dear.
I'm going to be real boring. Dungy for the win.
Didn't see that one coming.
Yeah, I know.
Original.
Jason Anderson.
Ooh. There you go. See, you forced her into
see?
That one.
See? Oh, mm-hmm. Man.
Jason Anderson and Tomac.
Tomac third?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Solid picks. Very solid.
Gosh, I wanted to say if Bubba races the whole race without going down or getting hurt that he'd be up there too, but
we'll see it then.
We'll see.
Jeez.
Can't change it now.
And I have one to
go.
Is
go Grant.
Okay.
Grant.
Grant.
G with a rant.
Yeah.
Don't maybe start ranting around.
Start.
I'm gonna say yeah, exactly. Being that it's Anaheim one, I don't want to pick predictable picks. I'm gonna go a little against the grain. I'm gonna say third place, I'm going to pick Dungy. I'm going to say second is going to be Canard, and I think Tomac might come out and shock the world. Not shock the world, but come out and just say, boom, I'm back.
Well, you know, I think that all of you are somewhat idiots because you're not thinking about the mud that's going to be in A1, and it's going to be raining, it's going to be cold.
Why are you always thinking about mud?
Ew,
drop
what?
The knowledge, girl.
You don't know it's going to be
dry race predictions.
Hold on, hold on,
no,
hold on.
No, yeah, no, you guys are shooting out
this
some dry
California,
race predictions.
This is California, and like
and there is
we're on
12
storm
inches
watch.
Of water no, on the tarps on at
storm
the
watch in California means there's a cloud in the sky.
No,
it's probably going to be nice on Saturday.
So you going Chad Reed?
No, I'm actually going to go Barsha up in the mix. I'm going to throw Barsha up
what about
in.
Wyndham? It's going to be a murder. Well, how about LaRocco?
I love LaRocco. Wyndham, and I wish that he was still racing.
I'm going LaRocco. Followed by Mike Fisher.
LaRocco is going to be winning from his semi. I'm going to go Barsha for second. Why second? I have no idea. I'm going to go Dungy for the win, and I'm going to go Roczen for third.
That was a weird way of predicting.
Wait, you just called
started
us idiots.
Started in the middle and went left.
And
right.
We went with
Dungy.
Wait, Dungy as the win.
Let me see your picks.
Yeah, I mean, he's won some
Dungy,
mud races.
Dungy, Barsha, Roczen.
Okay.
Daytona.
That's so out of the box.
Wow.
But I'm trying to figure out why we're idiots.
Yeah.
Or am I too stupid to figure that out?
Wait a minute. You guys didn't think you were idiots. Maybe, and then
no, I didn't. I'll be honest.
I still don't think I'm an idiot if you're asking me.
I just can't believe the chick, the only one with blonde hair here, is calling us idiots.
Because I have balls to call you an idiot.
All right, Caitlin, my predictions. My predictions.
You
all
are
right, reel
a
it
dick.
In. Reel it in. Reel
my
in.
Predictions will be.
Caitlin.
I think Anderson might win the race. And then I'll say Tomac, and then maybe. Yeah, I think it's either Canard or Dungy third.
We got a fan at home just text in
one.
Saying we're with you on Canard winning, Tomac and Anderson. That's their guess. The great skid plate.
But you know what's funny is with those picks, no one has Dungy or Roczen to win. Which
I do. I have Dungy to win.
Okay. Well, sorry, we're idiots.
Lorette said Dungy also.
The two girls next to you both have Dungy to win, but you got to pick an actual one.
And I don't even
want
to go with him to win.
So okay. All right. So what did I say?
You guys, Jeremy needs to pick.
What did I say?
You said Anderson.
Yeah, Anderson, Tomac, Dungy.
Anderson, Tomac, Dungy.
Okay. Anderson, Tomac, solid. Dungy.
Anderson.
I
for
forgot
the win.
What my picks were.
And I think, look, if Tomac can come away with a second or a third,
that's a pretty good start.
It's a win for him.
It's a win for him.
Yeah,
you know, he's got a lot to prove, and you know, I think
it's not just, a win for me.
He needs to make the right decision.
Dan, real quick before we go to our last break.
Yeah, no problem. I'm going James Stewart. Marvin Musquin and Justin Bogle.
You seriously?
Boom! Way out the box, dude.
Like, oh, he's the black sheep of that radio.
I don't know whether to fist pump you or just fist
him,
punch you.
Just give you one right in the chin.
Good pick. I'll go with that.
Hey, we got to take our last break. You heard the picks right there. The Action Sports Show, powered by Toyota Escondido. We'll be right back.
It's true. The best new cars make the best used cars. And Toyota of Escondido is once again number one in Toyota certified used cars and trucks. Feel confident driving with the peace of mind of a 160-point inspection and Carfax report.
Toyota of Escondido.
Toyota of Escondido.
You also get a 12-month or 12,000-mile comprehensive warranty from certified purchase date, plus a 7-year or 100,000-mile limited powertrain warranty from original date of sale when new. Please ask for complete warranty details.
Toyota of Escondido.
Toyota Certified Sales Leader for San Diego County for 2014.
The boys are back with two huge events coming to the Southland. Monster Energy Supercross. Brought to you by Mission Motorsports Irvine. January 9th. It all starts with the season opener. Then follow the action one more time with the best riders take over Anaheim January 23rd, all at Angels Stadium. Get your tickets now at Ticketmaster and participating Yamaha dealers. All seats $5 more day of show. Prices subject to market demand. Additional fees apply. January 9th and January 23rd only at Angels Stadium.
What's up, guys? This is Donnie from FMF Racing. When I'm not straight out of Compton slinging pipes on the corner, I'm listening to the Action Sports Show powered by Toyota of Escondido.
You're on, guys.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Action Sports Show powered by Toyota Escondido. We're just about to wrap up our big Supercross preview special here with the super panel here today, and we're just writing down our picks and everything. Anaheim 1 coming up this Saturday, and I didn't get to write that yet.
Oh. Jim, step it up.
Too busy hosting a show. Hello.
No, sorry.
Hey, but we have a lot of great hosts here tonight. Lorette Nickel joining us, Grant Langston, Diana Dahlgren, Jeremy McGrath, and the man, the prodigy himself, Dan McGranahan, is in house.
Big 00 negative.
The ex-child star turned radio show host. So good to have. So where were we at now?
We're going to do our picks for the 250.
Okay, you guys go on right now. You guys,
what happened to the title picks? Was that at the end?
Yeah, we were going to do that too, but we just took our time with the other picks. Jim couldn't get
I think A1 straight. Is too much of a, like, you know, to do the title. I think we have to get A1 established. Then next week we come back, do the title.
No, I think before A1 you have to pick a title. At least your number one guy if you can't pick the podium.
Okay. All right, well, we're going to 250s.
Well, let's make it quick. We only do have about like 5 or 6 minutes here left in the show. It goes quick.
Okay.
So who do you like? I'm going to just take you right now. Cooper Webb. He's my pick to win. No doubt about it. He's one of our guys,
dude.
And he's the baddest dude on the planet. So what do you want?
Yeah, you know.
He's going to have comp, but he is the baddest dude.
He is the baddest dude. We take a look at the list that's on here. You have some great talented riders. Alex Martin has gotten some podiums. Same with Zach Osborne, Jesse Nelson, Joey Savacci. These are all great riders in
supposedly
the 250
class. Supposedly Jesse Nelson is flying right now.
Yeah, I think he's going to be up. I think he's going to be up on the podium. Like,
I give him a thumb up for that one.
But I don't think he's going to be going head to head with Cooper Webb personally. So, I think Cooper Webb has this one in the bag as long as he can stay healthy. And I know Langston, you said that before we even started.
I think Nelson can give him some heat for a race or two, but I think overall it's Webb.
You also got Alex Martin out there.
Why don't we?
I think Savacci will ride good.
Why don't we throw a curveball?
I think Christian Craig.
Christian Craig.
If it's not,
he's going to be on the podium.
If it wasn't Cooper Webb, who? Like, just say he was injured.
Christian Craig.
Who could win races and win the title?
Christian Craig rides so good. Yeah,
He's got incredible natural talent.
He's
going to
get an incredible start. He's healthier than he's ever been.
I say he's getting first, second, and third place. He's that good.
So if it wasn't Webb, then it's got to be Nelson or Craig, I think.
Yeah. And like you said, Jeremy, I think Savacci could mix in there.
Savacci rides
even Bowers. Tyler Bowers is also.
Is Bowers riding West?
Bowers is not on West.
His name's not even on here.
Well, I just saw the list today, and he's listed as West Coast.
Okay. So then I think he's a top three guy.
So yeah. These are what these were the registered riders just before we started the show that it came off of AMA Supercross. So maybe he was added to the list.
Yeah,
I think
Bowers
he was.
Is,
let me double check.
Oh, here. Yeah. No, he is West 250 West.
Yep. Well, I Tyler think there, your there. Podium's going to be.
I say Webb, Nelson, Craig. That's my pick.
I say Webb, Bowers, Nelson.
I say Webb, Nelson, Bowers.
I say Nelson, Bowers, Webb.
I say Webb.
Do you bleed orange there?
Bowers, Savacchi.
I think Savacchi's going to be in the hunt. I just don't know where he's going to fit in. I like the way
I just like saying
right.
We're just talking A1, right? Are we talking the season?
Yeah, A1.
Oh, I'll leave it with that as well for the season.
A1, I'm talking Craig Webb.
Craig for the win?
Yep.
What about Dustin Pipes?
What about Osborne?
What about him?
Dusty? Osborne's a great and rider. Nelson. He just always leaves the season earlier, doesn't he? Because he goes
yeah,
over Europe.
Yeah, it's because he launches over the – oh,
over
Osborne?
The
no, Osborne leaves to go to Europe.
He did for a little while. I don't.
He's back now, full time Geico. Okay. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. These kids, like the Jordan Smith, also on a Geico bike. I don't know too much about him. I know Aldridge is fast. I know Savacchi's fast. Are they really going to go battle at the top with like the Webbs? I don't know. Alex Martin, I'm not really a Supercross. I don't think Supercross is his A game. I think he's a little too abrupt. But we know he's a fast dude.
He's a good rider. He's very consistent, but with all due respect, I feel like he's a little overrated.
Yeah.
He's a solid guy. If you just need someone to end every race, like, I'd hire him, but I don't know. He won a moto. I mean, that, you know, cool deal, but he's not there.
Who do you guys not know a lot about, but you'd like to see do well?
What do you guys think about Jimmy Dakotas as that guy?
Super
just
glad
because you said
totally
with all due respect doesn't
question.
Mean
no, no, no. I was saying as that guy.
Oh, okay.
Step Brothers.
Because I don't know that much about him. I kind of like to see him well, but I also kind of the reason there was some hesitation because I think a lot of people have some feelings towards him.
Why is that?
You want to get something off your chest, Dan? Like, is this something you want to share?
He's been one of those.
I saw him
park guys,
in Sydney. I was down in Australia for the Supercross.
Ooh. Dakotas.
Oh.
And he looked very good there.
Right.
Like, I don't know. Like, you know when someone shows up and there's no superstars in the 250 class and he's like, I'm the guy? He rode like that. And I watched him. And I was like, that's the first time, honestly, I was like looking at this guy going, he looks like, even though maybe the competition wasn't at the elite level, if he rode like that at the elite level, he would still be a contender. But I don't know. I think his legs are too short for Anaheim Whoops.
Okay.
How's Ricky?
I never had that problem.
Well, I'm like in between. I'm taller than him, but I still get my buttocks smacked by the seat.
If you have the right technique, I think you'd be all right.
True. Cool. Coming from Mr. Whoopmaster himself.
Mm-hmm. You didn't have a linkage on your bike, so it was a little hard.
Yeah, I had a bulldog style. Didn't work very well. I was one bad hop away from being ejected. But it's true, though, because look at someone like Reed. He perfected the Whoops. Look at his longevity in Supercross, how many times he was not injured as opposed to other guys. And I think you had that too, Jeremy. You know, you guys were very, you know, technical as well as got the tough stuff down. So even if you didn't win every race, you guys were always healthy, always there. And that's the key. It doesn't matter whether it's West Coast, East Coast, 250, 450. You got to be in it to win it. It's pretty
I agree.
Simple.
I think, you know, we can talk up here all day long, but, you know, you got to make all the starts. You got to make all the races to get all as maximize all the points.
All the
you got to get there and you got to be there in the end. And
well, there's only six of them.
Well, we're talking all the guys. I mean,
all
everything we've talked about tonight.
And they actually have eight.
All that could eight. Be different. You know, I mean, who knows? We're not going to be able to pick everyone. But you, in order to make all the make what, the championship, you got to make the races.
Yeah, it's pretty simple. There.
What about, like, the Troy Lee boys, like this Mitchell Oldenburg kid? Anybody know much about him?
I honestly haven't heard of that kid.
I mean, I know the name, but I don't know much about
yeah,
it either.
I don't know.
And you know, that's the thing in the Alliance class on the West is there's so many new kids coming up that you got to – you know, there's some kids that'll, you know, rise to the pressure and everything you hoped he would be, and there's going to be other kids that fail. And I think a lot of times for those youngsters, the first race can dictate how the season goes because it's still a lot
of
it's
weak,
a mental
yeah,
game.
If you're weak.
And a lot of them are still learning, you know. I think Webb's genuinely the only guy that's got legitimate confidence coming into it. Everyone else is hoping to do well, I think.
Webb's the guy that we've seen that he maximizes that pressure. He yeah. loves it. A lot of guys fold up like a house of cards. Oh, he excels when it comes to that.
Even on Instagram, he posted a video and said, I've taken it to another level. Because you know that some of his competitors are looking at that, and he knows that they're looking at it. But that's because he believes. You know, he's genuinely going in going, someone's really going to have to step up their game to try and knock me off.
Is that a tactic? Like, is he trying to?
I don't think so. Not when you really believe it. It's not
exactly.
It's a fine line between. But do you have to talk about it? Because wouldn't your results show?
Yeah, but before the season, you want your competition.
It's pretty gray area, I think. You know?
Just tell them you feel unbelievable. They start sweating. You know. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of it is mental too. If you go in to the press conference and say, "I've got this,"
he's not proving himself to be too mouthy. You know what I mean? He's just like confident. There's a fine line between cocky and confidence.
I agree.
Well, you heard it right there, folks. The big Supercross preview special, Anaheim 1, coming up Saturday. Ladies, gentlemen, thank you so much, the esteemed panel, for coming out here today and talking to everybody. What an awesome show. Thank all of you for listening. And I think some of them will be back next week, and we'll touch upon what happened over the weekend. It's going to be exciting. So a lot of cool stuff going on. I'd like to thank all of you for listening. Definitely check us out every Tuesday, 6:30 to 8:30. Go to theactionsportsshow.com for more information. Follow the social media. That's at TE Action Sports. At TE Action Sports. Download the podcast. We'll put good stuff into your ears every week for free. I guarantee it. From all of us here at the Action Sports Show, hope you have a great week. Remember, don't text and drive. We'll see you next time on the Action Sports Show.